Hi, I'm Allison Eyring, organization psychologist, CEO, and endurance athlete. I've spent the last 30 years helping companies solve the people and organization challenges of growth. I've worked with all types of CEOs and business leaders around the world, but it really takes a special leader to successfully grow a business at a rapid pace of change. I call them growth leaders. In this episode, we're going to learn about how to create and execute a winning growth plan, even when the world around you is changing so fast. I'm going to speak with Benjamin Zhou, Vice President for Southeast Asia and Emerging Markets at Facebook. Welcome, Ben.
Happy to be here. Thanks, Allison.
Yeah, it's great to have you. Ben, you've got a great history with Facebook. You started in 2011, which in Facebook years must be like 100 years. You've come a long way. You started in a strategy role, and now you're heading a region that's rapidly growing and changing very quickly. Can you tell us what countries are in your region?
Sure. So the countries that are in my region include all of Southeast Asia countries and emerging markets, which are mostly South Asia countries. So those are 12 plus countries, and I've been here now almost a decade. So I reached my 10-year phase-versary, we like to call it, a couple of weeks ago.
Congratulations. That's awesome. So Ben, your geographic span is so diverse. I'm just so curious, what would be two markets that you think are the most different and why?
Wow, that's a tough, tough question. So leading 12 countries, and every country I have a favorite on, it is very diverse, as you can tell. And I really don't have two flavors. Every country has a different flavor to it. But what I do think is interesting with this region specifically is the diversity of the community that we serve. So most recently, we had the Ramadan event. I set a vision for myself this year to read the Holy Quran twice. And I finished reading it once a couple of weeks ago as we finished up, as we had Eid. And I also joined our Muslim community with the Fastathon, which is always a fascinating experience. And I'm just really proud of being part of being this community and continue learning.
It's a great experience. I'm really interested in the fact that you started out in a strategy role. And then over this decade, you're now in a line role leading these different markets. And so for you, what would you say has been the biggest change that you've experienced in yourself as a growth leader?
Yeah, so I started as an individual contributor, which means that I didn't really manage any teams. I think the biggest change has been just finding great talent and empowering them to do greater things. I think that the biggest joy of my job has been able to lead teams and help them develop to do great things. And again, even with the expanded scope, being able to serve such a large number of communities across our countries, but also with the businesses that we serve, has been a big shift and a very fulfilling experience so far.
So Ben, I want to ask you a question a little bit different from developing and empowering people, really more around building a successful growth plan. What's one word that you would say describes a winning growth plan?
That's a hard, hard question. I think, at least from my personal experience, the learning mentality. I've been in the same role for about 3 years, but every day has been different. And with all the rapid changes that's happening, it's hard to lose sight of being bold and also being comfortable taking calculated risks. So one of the things that I really try to share with my teams is to make sure that I admit my mistakes and I share those mistakes with the teams around what I prioritized or what are some of the decisions that I've made historically that really didn't pan out. And I think that's, at least in on my teams, have built a culture where people can take risks but are not afraid to make mistakes and fail.
So you mentioned a learning mentality, which is so important for as a growth leader. But how do you reconcile the need to be learning and adapting with the need to have some type of a plan and predictability?
Yeah, and I love this quote. Speaking of plans, I love this quote by Dwight Eisenhower, where he talks about plans are useless, but planning is indispensable, right? So we spend a lot of time planning stuff. And one of the things that's worked really well for me is around doing vision writing. So what this is I'd sit down early in the year to imagine myself on December 31st of the coming year, myself sipping a glass of wine and trying to reflect on what happened in the year before. So this is all forward-looking things. And I've done this for about 7 years. The power of being able to think through, organize, and also share what your vision is has been extremely helpful. And obviously, plan is part of this, and because people help you be successful, achieve the goals that you've set for yourself, but also be able to deprioritize those things that are not important that needs to be done.
So I love that quote because it just reinforces the idea that it's not the paper or the plan itself. It's the act of figuring out and thinking through what the plan should be and what scenarios might be or what, how you might have to change. So it's really building a different thinking muscle than many of us might be used to. So Ben, I wanted to ask you a little bit about how do you reconcile the need to create a strategic direction and a plan when you're in an environment that is changing so much. And also you have 12 different geographies. And so each of those is also changing at its own pace and in different ways. So how do you as a leader find that balance between the consistency that you need in a planning process with the adaptability you need for so much change that's going on?
That's a constant challenge. And I think it's hard to strike a very good balance around that. But I think there's a couple of commonalities that we can take into consideration. One is around just being very diligent around sharing what your priorities are and being transparent around the direction of where the company wants to be, whether that is serving communities, helping communities build more communities, and helping businesses thrive on our platforms. So I make a very deliberate effort to be overly transparent, overly communicate in these type of environments, overly share my vision and directions, and just ruthlessly effort to over communicate. And at Facebook, we have a very flat culture where people are empowered to be builders, to have the autonomy to build out their plans and execute them. And I think with some level of these type of alignments and over communication around the direction of the company or your organization, it really has helped us enable and empower folks to make decisions and execute based on their expertise of work, whether that is building communities or helping businesses.
So I find so many times it's easy to keep getting more and more things to a list of priorities. What do you do to make sure that your list isn't always growing, that it's really the important things that you have to focus on?
Wow, that's always a hard challenge. I actually had a class this morning around prioritization. There's a couple of things that's been helpful for me, which is one, sharing what my priorities are on a regular basis. I think once you kind of get a hang of sharing that verbally, it helps you to at least structure or think through what the priorities needs, how they need to change going forward. So communicating that has been helpful. The second piece is also, we also have a list of things that we are not going to prioritize on. So you'll see as days go by, people will bring up things or have ideas around, hey, what about these things? Should we be doing these tasks or these type of priorities? And having a list of deprioritized things that you will deprioritize for the near future and being able to share that with your overall teams has helped us to focus on those things that have the most impact. And then lastly, just admitting some and giving people a visibility on how we're doing on the priorities. So, you know, priorities you share, but then also being able to share the progress that we're making, some of the course corrections that we will have to make on a tactical level has been helpful to getting that alignment across the teams.
I love your list. Do you really call it the deprioritized list or is it a do not do list?
Oh, we actually call it a deprioritized list.
I love it. And so you just say, I'm sorry, that's on the deprioritized list. We are not going to do it. That's great.
That is funny.
So I'm just kind of curious the way you all build your plans. Is that kind of a top-down or more of a bottom-up process? And what's the benefit of your approach?
Yeah, it's both. Look, at Facebook, if you visited any of our offices, there is a lot of posters in our office. And one of the first posters that I've seen when I joined about 10 years ago was this poster that says, this is now your company. And initially, I didn't understand what that meant, but now I do. What that means is everybody in all levels are empowered to make changes, to build things that better serve our community and the businesses and the teams. So, you know, we're very flat organizations, again. And going back to your questions around tops down or bottom up, it's both because from a top-down standpoint, we try to be overly transparent and over-communicate on the direction of where we want the company, the teams, and the businesses wants to go. And then everybody else who listens to that is now empowered to make the decisions that they need to make within their specialty of their jobs and roles.
That's really hard, you know, to inculcate a lot of ownership and empowerment with so much growth happening and so much change happening as you grow in different markets with different products, with different employee groups. So I think that's a great accomplishment. I want to know how you learned. I mean, I guess you had an advantage because you came out of strategy, and people that are trained in strategy generally know how to make good plans. However, what for you personally as a leader helped you the most? And say a little bit about, not just about creating the plan, but also of the this mental rehearsal and the thinking that you talked about, which is so beneficial to the planning act.
Yeah. There's a couple of principles that we try to put in place as we plan for these things. And one is just being very overly open and transparent. So not having an agenda, making sure that you received feedback from folks has been really important as we kind of go into that planning phase. And then the second piece is around just getting constant feedback. Look, we have people who are much, much more smarter and talented than individual wise. So receiving feedback has been a key in the planning process, but also in my personal journey of learning here. So I've been booed publicly during public speaking. I've also received horrible, not good performance ratings while I was at Facebook. What's the commonality from all this is I've received a lot of good feedback, and I've had allies, you know, at the company and also outside the company who's helped me gear and guide me through this journey. So having allies and having feedback along these processes, I think, goes a long way, especially when we're planning.
Okay, so I'm super curious about the booing incident, because these days a lot of people talk about psychological safety, and I'm thinking, if I'm standing up talking to a group of people and they start to boo me, I am not feeling very good about it. So what were they booing?
I choked. I didn't say a word for 2 minutes. And my speaking session was 8 minutes.
And they started to boo. Wow, tough crowd.
Yeah, it was a tough crowd, but I learned a lot. I think, you know, it's hard. I look back to it now and I laugh and smile and say it's a learning moment. At that moment, it is so, so difficult. And I think what helps you kind of come out of these tranches or, you know, take these learning experiences are allies. Like, so people, there were a few allies that I've had who were in the crowd, were friends, who came to me and said it was okay. Look, and they gave me, they cheered me up, helped me focus on what my strengths are, which I think my strength at that time was just keeping silent. Jokes aside, just things that I can improve on and help me along this journey. And those allies become your biggest fans. So next time I do another public speech, they'll be there and rooting you on and saying like, wow, look at that. This time you didn't stay silent. You actually spoke for the 8 minutes that were allocated to you, and they give you constructive feedback and you improve as you go.
That is a great story, Ben, because it really illustrates the importance of allowing ourselves to go outside of our comfort zone and to do things that we don't really feel competent about or maybe confident in. And then that allows us to grow and change. So that's a great story as a growth leader.
It was a great learning experience.
So now, Ben, I have an opportunity for you to match wits with our Prodigy software that uses our Grow in the Flow methodology to help people do real work and develop at the same time. Now, I have pulled out a sprint out of Prodigy, and what I'm going to do is ask you to tell me what you think you would recommend a person do if they were going to execute a sprint. So a sprint is a piece of work where you're delivering real results and you're using that to trigger your development. And this sprint is called Empower Team Execution. And so it's all about empowering teams to manage themselves around key work that's needed for execution. And given your experiences, I think this is one that you know a lot about. So let's say you're coaching somebody and you're trying to help them think about how they can empower team execution. What would be a couple of ideas or suggestions you might give them of actions they could take?
Two or three. So one, be open or overly communicate what your directions are, what your intentions are, where you want the team to be headed. Two, always be learning. Receive the feedback, ask for feedback that will help the teams grow, but also you grow yourself. And then third, have a protagonist mindset. Look, we can agitate and focus on a lot of things that we can't control, but that's probably not the best way of a growth mindset and also being able to execute the plans that are laid out. So focus, having a protagonist mindset, focus on the things that we can influence and where we go.
I think I really like what you just said about having a protagonist mindset. I find that interesting and a little bit intriguing because it's very, it sounds like you're having a point of view and you're going out there and you're telling and selling and sharing a set of ideas to others. Is that a correct understanding of it?
Yeah. And it's based on the trust that you have with your colleagues, right? So there's teams that specialize in a lot of the roles jobs that you might want to pursue. And so trusting that they have the expertise and your job is to make sure that you provide the right set of data or insights for them to make the decisions goes a long way versus trying to influence or actually trying to do their jobs. Because if I did their jobs better than they can, then I'd be doing that.
So Ben, one of the things that one of the actions that Prodigy recommends is to build capabilities in the team. So you're doing this sprint where you're empowering team execution. And sometimes the people that are doing the work also need to build new muscles. How do you do that? How do you do it quickly?
Yeah, I think one thing that's worked for us is actually giving them the space to fail. Obviously there's a lot of mentorship and learning that happens among managers and individual contributors. But I think nothing comes at the expense of, you know, being able to fail and having that sense of security that it's okay to fail as you try these new things. So, you know, we try to make sure that we build rooms and some level of space where it's okay to fail, and we share those failures as a learning, just so that people can feel safe to take calculated risks and be bold in building these muscles. Because again, building these muscles can be really tough and daunting.
Absolutely. I think you're reminding me of your story earlier, the powerful boo story, where you said you had allies, you know, so you had people around you that said, hey, it wasn't so bad. It's okay. Keep going. You know, you got this. I feel like that's really important, that we all need that community around us that can support us, because what you just said is so powerful. And that is that we've got to create the space to fail. If we don't allow people to fail, they'll never grow to their potential. So often we're just trying to protect them. So I love that. I've got one last question for you. So one of the recommended actions from Prodigy is to create oversight, which is about ensuring that you have a mechanism in place to have visibility and to monitor and to see how things are going. So I'm curious, how do you reconcile that with the idea of empowerment? So how do you find the right balance of getting visibility into what's happening and how things are going and empowering people to take action?
Yeah, that's a hard balance to strike. But some ways how we've been able to do it is through our regular check-ins, right? So we want to make sure that the check-ins are used in a way where people can ask for help. And, you know, at the same time, they feel empowered to do what they need to do. So as a manager, as a leader, I'm there to help them succeed. I'm there to help them execute on their plans. I'm there to make sure that they succeed in their role and the project that they're working on. So we make a deliberate effort to check in with how they feel they're doing. And obviously, that could be perhaps seen as some level of oversight. But the majority of the time is spent on how I can enable them, how I can enable the teams, how I can spend more time with teams, whether it's a personal matter or a professional, on helping them do more than they could have imagined of achieving.
I love that. That in Prodigy has you schedule weekly check-ins. And I think that routine is so powerful. Creating that space, having those conversations, and it gives your teammates an opportunity to say, hey, here's where I need your help. And it also gives you the opportunity not only to support them, but also to see, you know, what are the barriers? How do you help them connect the dots maybe with other groups? So I feel like that's a really important routine as a growth leader. So Ben, I have asked you all the questions I have. I've loved to hear your stories and your experience. Some of my takeaways that I'll remember. One is I just loved your quote about plans are worthless. Planning is indispensable. I feel like that's so great. I think your story of overcoming a failure is just so powerful and wonderful, because it says that, you know, from pain come great things. And I think that's awesome for a growth leader. And I love the way you think about finding the balance of, you know, sort of the driving the vision or the direction with the building and supporting and empowering people, because I think that's so important for growth leaders. I just want to thank you for taking time and sharing with us today and allowing us to learn with you and from your experience.
It was a pleasure speaking with you, Allison.
Well, thanks for listening today. If you liked what you heard, please subscribe to Growth Leaders wherever you get your podcast. Leave a comment and a rating. We'd love to hear what you think. If you have comments or questions about growth and growth leadership, be sure to mail us at growthleaders@organizationsolutions.com. Growth Leaders is produced by Organization Solutions in partnership with Media Corp.